Hi, everybody, and welcome to the first annual Journalism Media Studies Capstone Symposium. My name is Jonah Brooker Cohen. I'm an associate professor in this department, and today we have several presentations from graduating students for their capstone projects, as well as a few recorded presentations that will be shown after they're finished speaking. It's a wide range from journalism projects, to digital projects, to investigative media projects. So I'm looking forward to it. And our first presenter is Tiana Bailey, who will be talking about the world of NFTs. Thank you. All right.
Hi, guys. How are you guys doing? Good. Okay. Cool. Okay. Okay, so for my capstone project, I wanted to do it on NFTs. I wasn't really familiar with the concept at first, as were a lot of people. You know, they only started getting really popular in 2021. So the concept in general was just new for everybody. But it was growing at such a high pace that everybody was joining it and everybody wanted a piece of it. But along with the hype, there came some flaws that started to poke out with NFTs. And that's basically what I'm gonna discuss today. Okay. Okay, so that was basically it. Okay. So to address the elephant in the room, what are NFTs? So in comparison to regular currency like fiat or cryptocurrency, Those are fungible currencies, unlike NFTs, which are non-fungible, hence the name. NFTs don't follow the same route in terms of interchangeability or it just can't be exchanged for the same currency that it is. A dollar can be exchanged for another dollar, and one Bitcoin can be exchanged for another Bitcoin. NFTs are not cryptocurrency. They're a digital asset that allows you to own, it allows you to have ownership. And I think that's a part of the reason why it was so, why people wanted to join and get on the hype of NFTs, because it created ownership. People wanted something to own. You could trade digital assets before, but you could never own digital assets, and NFTs allowed you to do that. The authenticity was claimed through the blockchain using smart contracts to confirm its uniqueness, which then would allow artists to be able to monetize their work. And this ranged from a number of things, from photography, music, art, and even tweets. That's something that, you know, couldn't be done before. You know, someone saying that I just sold my tweet for $10,000 or something like that. You know, that's never been done. And NFTs are allowing, it's breaking a path in the digital world that we've never been introduced before. So yeah. So just a quick timeline on how NFTs really started. The concept was developed on March 27th of 2012 by Yoni Assia. If I'm not pronouncing that right, I'm sorry. He created a currency called colored coins. That was basically the concept that paved the way for NFTs. Colored coins was basically, it was a unique coin that was based off of Bitcoins. He wanted to adapt what was already done with Bitcoins, but have a unique version. So with this unique version, there was value added. And what's so interesting about NFTs is that it creates scarcity. And that creates a demand. And that's what really pulls it all together. So you have an object that not everyone's able to get to, but that one person wants it, It's a demand. And everybody wants it. And it creates a higher revenue. So after that, in 2014, on May 3rd, Kevin McCoy mints the first NFT called Quantum. Then it goes down into 2017 to 2020. NFTs are now on Ethereum. Ethereum was actually created in I know that it launched in 2015, if I'm not mistaken. And that's also when token standards were introduced. So token standards allow NFTs to be created. So with smart contracts, it's a protocol that deploys the tokens, and the tokens allow you to create. Then this moves on to the NFT and the gaming industry and metaverse. Facebook took their interest in NFTs as well, creating, transitioning into Meta. And the gaming industry, it's shown signs of interest of NFTs. Not a lot of developers have had success with NFTs like Ubisoft, but for gaming apps or just mobile gaming, there has been more success in that terms for NFTs. 2021, this is the prime of NFTs. The first NFT from Kevin McCoy's Quantum sells for $1.47 million in June. And then Beeple's NFT sold for $69 million. And then this is just where the huge surge of demand for NFTs starts. People see that it's creating so much revenue, everybody wants to join it. Okay. What I really wanted to focus on was the big issue that people have with NFTs. I've noticed from my deep dive of Reddit, everyone has an issue with authenticity. You know, we have a concept that claims that it creates an ownership and that it allows you to own this thing, but then there's that little detail that doesn't get shown. And it's credibility and authenticity and fraud. And this correlates to the art industry. Not even though artists aren't the only ones investing in NFTs, in a way it was sort of an opportunity for artists specifically. This was a way for artists to make money. This was a way for artists to find a new avenue of an audience. But artists felt as though NFTs weren't actually protecting them or doing what the claims were to be for, you know, the blockchain. Okay. So the uniqueness of NFTs starts to shift when art pieces are stolen. NFTs limit the factor of theft because of the unique coding added to any piece. Yet artists have experienced theft numerous times. And this is relating to artists who aren't minting NFTs. So for example, Quing Han, aka Quinny, known for her art on DeviantArt, passed away in February of 2020 from cancer at the age of 29. Before her death, she released an art piece called Birdcage, which is shown right there. And it was found by her brother that people were selling her art piece. People hadn't made money off of it yet, but the price that they were setting it at was extremely high. People were just trying to make a quick buck off of it. But it's the fact that these things happen, and she's not the only artist that has experienced this. There are people their tweets are being stolen for NFTs, and Twitter actually encourages that. They have an app separate that is catered to NFTs. The former founder had created that app as well, so that really shows you. Another thing, besides the ownership issues, artists aren't actually making money. And this is where the lines start to get a little bit more blurred. According to ArtNet, artists are only making $200 or less, which is the average sale. More than 50% of all record sales were under $200. So this creates a misleading market to newcomers expecting to make thousands and millions. And this also creates a swarm of crypto grifters who essentially feed off the newcomers. But what's interesting about the newcomers specifically, in an interview I had with Nicole Cohen, a new media digital artist, she was basically saying that if you go into making NFTs with the mindset of making money, you're not going to make money. But that can be said for a whole range of things, that if you go in with the idea that you're going to make money, you're just not going to make money. You're not going to make the profit that you want. So even though it does create a misleading market, you still can't go in head on thinking that you are going to make money off of this. Because in some senses, you actually put in more money than you get in. So another big factor that NFTs have caused are that it uses an immense amount of energy. It requires a large amount of electricity in order to mint because it uses a proof of work procedure, which there's a fee that's needed in order to mint these NFTs, which is called gas. And to keep all these records secure, proof of work pushes out puzzles that need to be solved. So everyone is trying to solve these puzzles, which uses a lot of energy. It was stated that it uses the same amount of energy as Livia, and that equates to 22,000 hours of watching YouTube. Okay. So even though NFTs has its flaws, people are still investing. Artists aren't the only one investing in NFTs, and there are two main industries that are actually benefiting from NFTs. And one of those would be real estate. I was actually surprised that real estate would even be investing in NFTs, but it actually makes sense. NFTs allow transactions process of ownership to be done in minutes, and that's really beneficial for real estate agents because of paperwork. That was their main issue. It connects buyers and sellers and allows buyers to claim when contract conditions are met. They are also implementing a way to have your mortgage done with NFTs. So that was also an interesting concept as well. Then there's the gaming industry. Where it implements a play to earn and skin in games and items, and of course the metaverse. Okay, future of NFTs. NFTs could have a bright future and could be enjoyable for all users if regulations are made. There are currently regulations being encouraged because of its popularity, but they aren't really implemented. DeviantArt is one of the few marketplaces that are flagging stolen NFT art because of the whole issue with Qing Han. So that was as unfortunate as it was that happened. You know, companies are realizing that they need to add more regulations to their websites in order to stop fraud. So the best way to double down on fraud would be to implement the KYC and AML measures. KYC is Know Your Customer, and it depends on the anti-money laundering AML procedure in order to actually work. not a lot of companies are using these regulations, but it would be beneficial as it would help stop fraud and money laundering, which are two big factors that have been playing with NFTs and which has been giving it such a bad name. If these marketplaces had these regulations, there would be a less like, people would less likely be so negative about NFTs. There'd be more of a positive outcome. There are environmentally friendly options as well. The best way to deduce the carbon footprint of NFTs or crypto in general is to use other blockchains than Ethereum, which includes Tezos, Voice, Flow, and Cardano. These blockchains offer user-friendly interface while making its platform eco-friendly. Are NFTs a fad? So according to Yale Kennedy, sorry, I can't pronounce that one, the rave for NFTs will continue to rise in comparison to the crypto market at large. More than $17 billion in sales of NFTs were made in 2021, and it started off the year of 2022 by reaching a record high within sales at $6.13 billion. So, NFTs have come a long way and may continue to push boundaries within industries and our personal life if it becomes a regulated entity. This is a form of revolutionary technology. It's only going to adapt, and it's only going to become bigger and better in the near future. I don't think that people like NFTs, mainly because of the fact that I've said it multiple times that it's not regulated, and because it pushes the little man, and these little men are the artists. And artists feel as though that they're just going into another market that is pushing them down. You know, in the traditional art market, they're already money laundering and there's already fraud. So for NFTs to produce the same thing without regulations, because it's already harder to regulate the art market itself, it just creates an ecosystem where no one really wants to invest in. And also, the whole thing with fraud and money laundering, I don't think it's really fair to say that NFTs aren't the best option because of those factors, because in all honesty, that's how it is in the real world as well. Banks have experienced money laundering and fraud multiple times. FAFSA has, you know, experienced fraud at least. There are so many real world aspects that relate to the things that are happening to NFTs. I think because of how new it is, people are so quick to attack it. But it just needs to be regulated. And which it's already getting press from courtrooms, and you know, then this is not only in America. This is from Singapore and Japan, and you know, all these countries are interested in regulating it because of the issues that it's caused. So that is all to end my project. If there is any questions. Don't all jump at once. It's fine. Cool. Great.
Oh. Hey, Tiana. Hi. Congratulations on a great capstone.
Thanks.
Just a really basic question.
Yeah.
How did you get interested in the subject?
So originally my capstone idea was going to be, automated artificial intelligence guns. Yeah, so when I realized that I couldn't find enough information on that because it was a very new concept, but it was a very interesting concept that has already been implemented, I switched to NFTs. I don't really remember how I even found it. I think I was just looking for new technology, and NFTs was like the first thing that came up, and this was around I found it around January too, and which was when the hype started to really show more as well. Yeah.
Great. Our next presenter is Samantha Haas, who's talking about Displaced, an untold story of the New York City eviction scam. Very interesting. So we'll leave it up for Samantha. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? Okay, so for my capstone project, I decided to create a 3-episode podcast detailing an eviction scam that is part personal experience, but also part investigative story on what happened. So the first thing that I want to go and talk about is how... Sorry, I'm short. housing law in New York City is really expansive. So with my piece, I used my personal experience to try to break down and make clearer of how it's actually set up and what needs to be done to fix that problem. So in my freshman year of college, my mom and I got sent an eviction letter for the first time. And for pretty much my whole entire college experience, I've been dealing with the aftermath of that eviction and everything that occurred with it. My mom had to travel back and forth from housing court each time. And during the process, we owed maintenance arrears. So we owned an apartment, was what I'm saying. We owned an apartment, so it's maintenance arrears, it's not rent. We got sent to court because we owed maintenance arrears. The manager of my apartment building had encouraged my mom to go to court and see if, he used the term that there's lots of money, that's his words, that are given away in court and that the judge would be happy to help my mom pay back what we owe. We had two judges, but the first judge had encouraged my mom to go to APS. But because my mom is a legal resident, she's not a citizen, any type of government assistance that we would get would come against her status as an immigrant. And because this happened in 2019 with Donald Trump, there was a heightened fear of, that kind of thing. And we were still pushed to try to get a grant from APS, which never came to fruition. We had to deal, APS is the adult equivalent for Child Protective Services. So they mainly focus on assistance for adults who are maybe mentally incapacitated or physically incapacitated, which neither one, my mom is. But we were still pushed to try and get a grant that never came to fruition, like I said. And we were also given a guardian ad litem, which is a figure in the court that is supposed to work on your behalf that did not work on our behalf at all. And him, along with my building's manager and my landlord's attorney, were trying to get as much money as they could from APS via this grant, which is why my mom was constantly back and forth through court for pretty much the whole year. We didn't get evicted until the following December. So December 2020, I want to say we got evicted. But that was mainly because my mom obviously did not want to go ahead with this whole scam situation. So all of that, I decided to put together a podcast talking about that and sharing that story, but also creating a piece trying to explain like what situations are there that allow for misuse like this to happen. And when I made the podcast, I reached out to a number of different organizations, but I received responses from Take Root Justice and Mobilization for Justice, who both work to provide legal assistance to people who need it in terms of evictions. And what I learned from, and when interviewing these three people from these two organizations, I knew that when I was interviewing each one, I wasn't going to get a full concrete story of everything that happened with me, right? So with each one, I sort of focused on a different aspect of housing court. So one of them I spoke to about the process of an eviction. Another one I spoke to about the process of adult protective services and its structure. And the third one I spoke to about the process of a guardian ad litem and what sort of cracks exist. With all three of them, they did talk about how there was a lot of cracks in the system that allow for this misdirection and misuse to occur. So originally when I pitched my assignment, I pitched it as a 4 to 5 blog post website kind of thing. And upon talking with my advisor, Professor Markey, I sort of realized that it's a lot to talk about. And if I did go through with the blog post, it would just be a whole bunch of words and a whole bunch of reading. And it's a story that I feel like is best told heard as opposed to just read, and I want people to hear like my emotions and all of my thoughts that have occurred while going through the situation. And while making this podcast and talking to these attorneys, I realized that, well, first of all, I'm not the only one that has experienced a really bad experience with housing court. I spoke to one attorney that works where his office had to sue adult protective services on more than one occasion, either because they were doing too much for somebody or they were doing too little. And one instance that he spoke about in his interview was where he had a tenant who was stuck in an abusive relationship with somebody who took them to Las Vegas and abandoned them there, just left them out there to roam around. The tenant was a paranoid schizophrenic, so that didn't help the situation either. When she got sent back to New York, there was a housing case that was pending against the tenant because they weren't paying their rent. In that case, APS sort of declined to help that person because they said they had the knowledge and the know-how to go to Las Vegas. So therefore, they should have been able to pay their rent. And on an opposite occasion, he spoke about a tenant that APS had said that they would take the Social Security check from them so that they can pay their rent and all of their bills, lighting, energy, whatever. And then they misplaced their records of this. So they were taking this person's Social Security check every month, but claiming that they weren't getting it. And this tenant was then up for eviction afterwards. So with that interview, I realized that I'm not the only person that had such a negative experience with APS, but nobody should be having this negative experience with an organization that's designed to help people. So reflecting on making this podcast, what I learned is, first of all, that there's more than one way to just tell a story. There's more than just writing a story. You can speak a story. You can do other ways to document and tell a story and still convey the same kind of emotion. With journalism, I always try to find a way to make things that are super complicated and simplify them so that other people, anybody who's listening, can understand. And I think with this podcast, that was my main goal, was trying to simplify this really complicated 4-year situation that I went through and sort of simplifying it and explaining what's wrong with the system, what needs to be fixed. Also, I just learned how to use Audacity a lot better than what I used to know. Audacity, when you first start, it's really kind of all in your face and confusing. But I learned how to use it a lot better to create my podcast. And I guess that's it. There's any questions?
Hey, is this quite personal, but is this still an ongoing story, or is there an end yet, or did it end yet?
Well, you would think it would end when we got evicted, but it actually hasn't ended from there. My mom and I actually get sent bills every month as if we're living in the apartment. And I'm not sure what the reason for that is, but every month we get maintenance bills as if we're living there, and we're not allowed to live there because we were taken out by a marshal.
So another personal question, like, do they expect you to pay that, or, because that's like harassment at that point?
I'm not entirely sure what they expect from us, because the whole reason why they were pushing that APS grant was to try to get money out of the city, and it was not just the money that we owed, but also money for just like their pockets, right? So it was a scam in the sense that they just want extra money. But in terms of sending us maintenance bills, I don't know what the thought process behind that is.
You've done a lovely job, and you did a lovely job speaking about it. It's fantastic, like presence and stage presence and poise.
Thank you.
And you're talking about really complicated things, and you're also talking about personal things, and you're doing a lovely job of being present and presenting. The podcast you made is obviously quite long, and so we didn't have the capacity in this forum to air it. But could you tell us what each episode is and how you decided to break it down the way you did?
Sure.
Like what we will hear in each episode when we do.
Sure. So the hardest thing with making the podcast was trying to take everything that happened and just take the most important parts to talk about. So the first episode was really just me sort of explaining us getting the eviction letter, and then also talking about the process of an eviction, what a legal eviction looks like versus what an illegal eviction looks like. The second episode is more about the organizations that my mom encountered in court. So that's Adult Protective Services, that's Housing Court. And then the third episode, which is the last episode, is my mom's experience with a guardian ad litem, which, like I said before, is they sort of become you in a court case. They're mostly used in like family court cases, but they can be used in housing court cases, but they're usually only used if the person is not physically able to attend in court, which was not my mom's case at all, but we were still given a guardian ad litem. And once they are like involved in the court case, it's very complicated and hard to get them out, because any type of documentation in court that you want has to come from the guardian ad litem. So essentially it's like they take away your rights to make a court document and send it into court, because if it doesn't come from the guardian ad litem, they won't acknowledge it.
It's really, I think some people might be familiar with the Free Britney conversation in the last year. Like that's what this is. That's what this is for a family that did not have the mental crises that Britney did early in her career. But this is the sort of legal, yeah, somebody capturing someone in a legal system the same way Britney was. Can you tell a little bit about some of the research you did that didn't make it into the piece? You did some, you know, you did other research, other legal research, just to explain sort of how the journalism works versus what we end up hearing.
Sure. So there's a lot that I said that I took out of or I didn't include in my podcast, because it was like, it's like 4 years of my life that I have to break down and make most important. But I had to research how Bronx Housing Court and just City Housing Court in general, how it's structured. I had to research about guardian ad litems in the sense where I had to figure out like where they came from, like why are they a thing in housing court, and what that looks like in housing court versus what it looks like in like family court. The Adult Protective Services, I actually couldn't find a lot of information on them, believe it or not. But they are sort of, they're under the funding and the guidance of the Human Resources Administration, which is the HRA. In terms of just researching that, I found that there was a lot of things that, like, I know I'm not the only person that experienced them, which I guess is sort of bittersweet, right? Because it makes me feel, like, better knowing that, like, I'm not the only one. But it's also, like, I would never wish this on my worst enemy. Like, it's just so much to go through. And I just hope with my podcast that the right people hear it. And, like, in my wildest dreams, it's, like, my breakthrough piece. And, like, I get a job at, like, New York Times or something like that. But, on a smaller scale, I just hope that the right people hear it and the right people are able to sort of push for some type of changes. Because with the APS and GALs, from who I spoke to and who I researched, there's not a lot of talk about sort of reforming those organizations, and it really should be reformed.
At the beginning of your presentation, you said that your mother owned the apartment.
Yes.
Right? So what happened when you were evicted? Did you get the value of the apartment?
No.
You lose everything in that
we
situation?
We lose everything. Whatever, usually what happens in an eviction is that a marshal will come to your door and they tell you to, like, take whatever bags of things that you have and you go. So that is what happened, and then we left. And literally not even within the next month, we started getting maintenance bills again. So it was like we were taken out by a marshal, and we still get billed as if we're living in the apartment.
I just want to underscore the complexity of the story that Samantha stumbled upon by living it. I've covered housing and housing policy for 25 years in the Bronx. I know a lot of lawyers who work on housing policy. I know a lot of people who write policy. She discovered something new because she experienced it, which is really, to my mind, like the strength of the journalism program that we have here. If we're able to help students cultivate the clarity of thought and the research skills to do policy analysis and to do storytelling, the expertise and the skills that our students arrive with, the access to different parts of life that our students bring to the campus, means that they're able to see and do reporting that a lot of other people can't. So unfortunately, because Samantha had to go through this situation, she has this intense expertise and really was bringing a problem to people who spend their days thinking about housing policy that they were unfamiliar with. So when she called New York Legal Services and Bronx Housing Court and, like, Movement for Justice, all these organizations that work to advance housing rights and affordable housing rights, what they told her was, like, wow, you're telling us something new. We were unfamiliar with this scam. There is, there is no end, as the NFT story showed as well, right? There's no end to the depravity of alienating people from their money. But this is a new one. And so Samantha was really working up at the edge, like in the best way, right? At the edge of her knowledge, at the edge of her expertise, and going to consult policy experts who said, huh, that's a new version of an old way of separating, frankly, of separating Black women from their property. So I was, among the research she did is like reading great books by Kianga Yamada Taylor, who wrote a whole book recently, her most recent book on the separation of Black women from their property in the most recent housing crisis. You're like very logical, like, wait, but they owned it. How could they get evicted? Like, yeah, exactly. Like, yeah, that's exactly.
I also want to point out, I don't think I mentioned it in my presentation, but I should have. So over the course of this whole mess, I guess I call it a mess, my mom and I were able to pay back like all of the maintenance that we owed plus what we had to pay every month. So by the time we got evicted, there was actually no maintenance that was owed. It was just legal fees. So we got evicted for legal fees. We didn't get evicted for maintenance, which is a whole other part of the story that like is confusing and it's weird because who gets evicted for that? But that is what happened with me. And from what I spoke to with a couple of lawyers, it was a practice for a while that legal fees would get added to people's back rent or people's maintenance arrears, and they would never be able to pay it. So one reason that, like, prior to the pandemic that people were getting evicted was because of this addition. And so, yeah, that was another part of the housing law that's also, like, really complex and confusing.
Cool. Our next presenter is Daniel Roman, who's going to talk about Japanese media and its influence. Here we go. Thank you.
Hello, hello, can you hear me? Good morning, everybody. I'm Daniel Roman, and today I wanted to talk about something near and dear to my heart is Japanese media. So when we talk about Japanese media, we often think about anime and some kung fu movies, maybe just a little generalization there. But the advent of the internet and the increasing technology in media has opened the borders, our borders, to new content, new foreign content that comes to here to America. So growing up, I always used to just watch Saturday cartoons, very normal. But what I never realized is that watching Pokemon at 9 in the morning and playing Nintendo games like Mario, Legend of Zelda, and Metroid wasn't an American concept. It was a Japanese concept. So at times I would stay up late watching Toonami, and I would watch Dragon Ball Z, which is also Japanese content. But as the years went on, I realized that this content was also influencing our movies, our TV, our music, and many other things. And so my capstone is basically broken down into three things: sci-fi, video games, and movies and TV. So really what it comes down to, some precedents, are the penetration of Japanese media, like anime, that will lead to the growth of Japanese culture. America is a mosaic. We are many different cultures in one country. We're not a mixture, because if we mix, we're diluting. We're not truly unique. Here in America, I want us to be unique, because we are unique. The intermingling of and a collaboration of will create new media, such as with Disney, and the referencing of media texts and works, and lastly convergence culture, different cultures here in America, having living together, being together, will become similar over time, and it shows in this media. So first, I wanted to talk about really science fiction. Science fiction in history has always been an important genre, because it's always been sort of a look into the future, a warning per se, mostly. So things like Akira, which in 1998 has had monumental effects in science fiction and the anime industry. With it has influenced many works such as Dragon Ball and helped pave the way for anime here in the United States. Ghost in the Shell is another important work that helped influence such movies such as Avatar. It influenced James Cameron to narratively to make such an important piece on environmental destruction and the destruction of native cultures. And the Wachowskis to make The Matrix, which is a dystopian media that will give us a glimpse of how the rampant technology can destroy us. And really, if you watch Transformers, thanks to Japanese media, we have that today here in America. So, to continue, Godzilla is also a very unique and iconic Japanese character. A big lizard that also influenced Steven Spielberg to make another big lizard movie, which is Jurassic Park. So Godzilla, together with another iconic American character, King Kong, creates the MonsterVerse, which is a cinematic universe based on large monsters by Legendary Pictures, which they were influenced by Marvel because it makes so much money. And Guillermo del Toro's 2013 film Pacific Rim pays homage to the mecha and the kaiju genre. To cap off the science fiction is the introduction of a new subgenre, right? Subgenre known as cyberpunk. The cyberpunk is an important speculative fiction that will be explored in the coming years. And why? Why is that? Because it talks about us. It talks about the introduction of new technologies such as computers and how over time it can lead to our destruction, how it can have massive destructive effects on us, humankind. And so things like capitalism and corporate authoritarianism and the rampant technology, which with the inclusion of drugs, can absolutely affect us and is happening today. Video games. Video games, as you know, is a large, very large industry. Billions of dollars are being invested in this industry. Nintendo at $15.3 billion and Sony $24.9 billion. Both two of the biggest companies in the world, but they are not American. They're Japanese. With their presence, they also influenced Microsoft and Bill Gates to create my Xbox, which now we see today, both three of them dominate the industry today. But most importantly, with Japanese media and American media combining, we get a collaboration known as Kingdom Hearts. Disney, a really a child-friendly brand, as many of you know, mixes with Square Enix, who are the creators of Final Fantasy. It's a franchise filled with dark and complex characters and plot. So this intermingling will create something very new, something very light versus something very dark. They'll create something very special in many of us fans. In TV and movies, we get Dragon Ball that's absolutely just powered its way here in the West with its action, its powers, and with the dubbing has really helped make its way here in America. Miyazaki, with its beautiful anime works, creates this wonder of how we here in America can create something very similar. With that, we get The Boondocks. The Boondocks, created by Aaron Magruder, was influenced by anime. And in his words, it's our attempt at anime, but it's very, very black. Avatar: Last Airbender is also another influence by Miyazaki. They say, we just naturally want to respect people and cultures. Part of the reason why we created it was admiration of Miyazaki's films and Asian culture. So it came out of a love and appreciation of it. So it was just natural to honor it the best we could. So to really bring it all together, I created three different videos that goes into detail, more detail on what and how Japanese media has influenced American works. Part one is about science fiction, part two is about video games, and part three is about TV and movies. The reason why I really wanted to do the videos was because there's a lot of information. A lot of our media is visual, so you really need to see it in order to really understand of how it has been influenced. And I also just wanted to showcase my editing because I believe it's a great way to express yourself creatively. And so I wanted to show everyone here today part one of the video. Let me just find it. What's here? Thank you.
Japanese science fiction is unique and has spanned several different subgenres. In the 1960s, Osamu Tezuka, known as the godfather of manga, created Astro Boy.
Presenting Astro Boy!
Astro Boy was monumental to the anime industry and to cyberpunk. This work would inspire both the genre and the industry as a whole. Many defining qualities that make up art style of modern anime can be traced back to Astro Boy. The theme of Astro Boy is closely related to the iconic story Pinocchio, the theme of what it means to be a human being. Later on in the 70s, Tezuka's work and that of others would help create the subgenre known as the Mecha.
The Gundam Universe, a new chapter in one of the greatest anime sagas of all time, Gundam Wing.
Mecha is a subgenre of science fiction that features huge robots that are either sentient or piloted by humans. There are various works that fit under them. One of the most famous mecha shows in the world is Transformers was created with the collaboration of Hasbro, an American toy company, and Takara Tomy, a Japanese toy company. Shoji Kawamori designs the Transformers, first starting out as toys, but then Hasbro would hire Marvel to create a unique backstory for these colossal robots. The Transformers franchise would spawn three generations and many shows and movies. In 2007, famous director Michael Bay would direct the live-action film starring Shia LaBeouf and Megan Fox. The film was a box office success that would spawn multiple sequels and a couple spin-offs, one of the highest-grossing film and media franchises of all time.
Guillermo del Toro's 2013 film Pacific Rim pays homage to the mecha and kaiju genre.
To believe in each other. The day we face the monsters that are at our door, today we are canceling the apocalypse!
A landmark film in its own right, the rise of anime and the anime boom wouldn't be possible without what is considered as one of the greatest science fiction films of all time. Akira. When we talk about anime as a global industry and its influence on the media, there is no film like Akira. Akira is the movie that influenced many other popular works such as Akira Toriyama's Dragon Ball, Masashi Kishimoto's Naruto, and the anime for Pokemon that paved the way for anime and influence in the West. A film that would heavily impact the science fiction genre for many years to come and would influence the cyberpunk wave with its aesthetics and tone. There's just a certain glow that Neo Tokyo gives off. Based on a manga with the same name, the film follows Jotaro Kaneda, a leader of a biker gang whose childhood friend develops telekinetic abilities and goes on a rampage to free an entity known as Akira. The gorgeous design, phenomenal art, and animation, the complex story is what made it garner a cult following. The music video of Kanye West's Stronger pays homage to the movie. Many American cartoons will reference Akira in a very specific way.
wish I could reach your moon.
Ghost in the Shell is a cyberpunk thriller film based on the manga of the same name. The design and the aesthetics of the film will inspire several science fiction franchises. It follows a cybernetic operative, Major Kusanagi, who works for the secretive Section 9 in the fictional Newport City. She performs hit jobs and covert ops to find a notorious Puppet Master, a ghost hacker who is hacking the minds of civilians and politicians. The film explores the theme of souls and minds. Souls can be digitized into ghosts and then implanted into cybernetic bodies. It explores the horrifying concept of getting your mind hacked. Implanted memories, what is real and what is not? When your soul gets transferred into a cyborg body, are you still human? Are you truly alive? The visuals from animation and the aesthetics are one of the reasons why Ghost in the Shell is an important film in the science fiction genre. The film influenced James Cameron and has cited the film as inspiration to make Avatar the highest grossing film of all time, and the Wachowskis to make The Matrix, which would help influence that cyberpunk subgenre. Ghost in the Shell would get a live-action adaptation in 2017, adapted by the 1996 classic and starred Scarlett Johansson. With all this talk about cyberpunk, what is cyberpunk? A casual explanation would be a ramble about androids, neon lights, flying cars, and drugs. There's more to the genre than just advanced tech. There lies the underbelly of corruption, corporate authoritarianism, and the rampant advancement of technology. Towering skyscrapers, flying cars, and body enhancements juxtaposes to the dirty slums filled with narcotics and crime. Fundamentally, it is characterized high-tech and low-life. Cyberpunk is a subgenre of science fiction in a dystopian setting that can serve as a warning on possibly where our society is headed. Films such as Blade Runner, Akira, Ghost in the Shell, and Tron are some of the films that would help make up the subgenre. It's a cultural movement that explores the rise of high technology and the decay of humankind. The cyberpunk genre would directly influence the Cyberpunk 2077 game by CD Projekt.
Wake the fuck up, samurai. We have a city to burn.
And yeah, that's part one of the project. So yeah. The mic?
Yeah, questions.
Hi, Daniel. I wanted to say I really enjoyed your kind of deadpan expertise as a commentary, stitching the pretty dramatic images and music together. It was this great sort of point, counterpoint.
Thank you.
And it also... There's a poet that I've taught named Andrea Abikaram who writes as a cyborg or writes in the persona of a cyborg. So that this explained sort of what I stumbled on in that work. And my question is really I have two questions, and one, if it's too broad, just skip to the second one. But the first one is, what about this cyborg genre or the cyborg culture allows artists to, as you say, answer what it means to be human? Like, that seems like a paradox to me. And then the second question is,
what is lost when it gets translated from a Japanese context to not just an American context, but the context of Hollywood, which is, you know, super high budget and perfect looking movie stars?
So those are both great questions. To answer the first one, really when we do, when content creators make this media about androids and cyborgs, they really, in one aspect, they really want us to show this advancement of technology, that's what it really means, and how that advancement can really hurt us if we're not too careful. Because yes, this advancement of technology is amazing, right? It's a great way to help people get comfortable, help people with their lives. But for example, in James Cameron's Terminator, it's a huge dramatization, but how we are just not careful of how this technology is advancing. And to don't have some, to err on the side of caution sometimes, have a fail safe, just be safe, and things of that nature. And another aspect, the reason why they create this media is to show things how like corporate authoritarianism and capitalism really affect us, right? We feel soulless. We do our jobs every day. Sometimes I don't know about any of you beautiful people here, but sometimes we just feel soulless and crushed, and we just feel like a cyborg. We don't feel like a person anymore. That could be due to stress and just life in general. Life in the big city is hard. So that's another way why they want to make this sort of media. To answer the second question, a lot is lost. Really, Hollywood is just not good with bringing or adapting these things. As we saw, Netflix made a series based on Cowboy Bebop, a live-action adaptation of it, and it just wasn't good. A lot of like the ideas of the original series were lost. And to directly reference my video, the movie with Scarlett Johansson, The Ghost in the Shell, live adaptation, was just not good. Like, a lot of ideas were lost. Granted, Scarlett Johansson is an amazing actress, always has been, but you know, what can you do with a bad script and this bad direction?
That was an amazing display of editing. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Really fantastic cuts and quick and smooth. And congratulations. You wanted to showcase your editing. You did a really lovely job of showcasing your video editing skills. That's really great. I have two questions just observing this. I'm struck by the persistence of atomic energy, right? It's been 75 years, but so many of this Japanese imagery is referencing Hiroshima and Nagasaki, like clearly referencing Hiroshima and Nagasaki over and over. I mean, I saw many of those images of the beginning of the mushroom bomb, the destruction of the city, the infection of the self of the body with radioactivity or with some outside force, the mechanization of society that came in Japan after the destruction of the cities. So that's one, like, just noticing, like, wow, it's 75 years and there is a culture still traumatized by and trying to somehow process the world-ending bombings, right? The attempted world-ending bombings. But then the other thing that's really notable, right, if this is a form of art centered or like begun in a non-white place, the whiteness of the characters has always amazed me in anime. Mm-hmm. And the fact that anime is so popular among US people and among, you know, all my students of color, I guess what I'm asking is sort of, what does that mean that Japanese art is still grappling with the destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki? And what does it mean that so many young people of color are consuming an art form that is like very, the skin of the characters is white, their eyes are round, right? They're not Asian-looking people, their eyes are round. Their eyes are almost always blue, and the women are incredibly sexualized. You never see a woman in anime who doesn't conform to like the most aggressive sexist stereotypes. Mm-hmm. Even when she's doing something that displays agency, she's wearing a bikini. Mm-hmm. So what does that mean, that this art that is so influential is still grappling with a war from 75 years ago, and then is that young people of color are consuming and loving and like finding identity in a thing that is so really heavily racialized? It's mysterious to me, but it's really racialized European as far as I can tell, even though it originates as a Japanese art. And then, so that's all just one kind of question.
Yeah.
But what does that mean, that we consume this and create this? And then my other question is, you've said really clearly multiple times in your spoken presentation, in your video, and then just again, that this is a warning, that a lot of this form of art, that these films, that cyberpunk is a warning to beware, to be careful. And if we think about, you know, like Terminator came out when I was a little kid, right? Like these, it's a long time warning, right? This is going on 40 years, Blade Runner, right? Like this is a long time ago that we started warning. So what are the actions that are suggested by this warning? If this is a very popular, wide form of culture that exists to warn us, you know, we've either heard it or we haven't. So what do you, as a person who's immersed in this and who've now studied it academically, what do you think the steps are to take? It's one thing to have a warning. Once it's received, then what are the steps suggested?
So to answer the first question, the reason why they still tackle this destruction of Nagasaki and Hiroshima and the connection with POC is this universal thing of trauma. Today, even today, POC is still affected by a lot of trauma dealt many years ago. But based on the systems in place, such as racism, institutional racism to be exact, a lot of these things are still felt. They still feel that trauma. People don't forget what they've done to you. And so they want to express that the destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki was huge, all right? In our history, we say that the destruction of those two places in Japan was necessary to end the war. But over time, we realized that there could have been another way to end that war, far less lives. But the destruction is done, and America and American history suggest that we will destroy, regardless of any other possibility, right? Even in the coming future, we will probably destroy something, and we're probably going to be blamed for it. Why? Because it is our fault. And we're currently destroying today. We go to other countries, the war on terror, for example. Just another way to put this idea of destruction in them. And to answer the second question, what are ways of how we can stop this? What are steps that we can take to prevent this disaster that is forthcoming? Like I said, caution. And really, technology is great, but really what it comes down to is money. It needs a lot of money to fund these things. And with cyberpunk, it talks about hand-in-hand corporate authoritarianism, how greedy corporations will use this technology for money and you won't care about the destruction of people, of our minds. That's what the cyberpunk genre is really all about. We can look at this media and say, okay, we will be careful, but history suggests that we are just not as careful as we seem to be. I'm sure that when, for example, when German scientists here in America were making the bombs, they knew of the possible destruction. They knew what they were doing, but did we stop it? No, we didn't. We used it and we destroyed it. Just so that is what cyberpunk is all about. Can we really stop ourselves from destroying? Not really. When it comes to money, money rules all, and at the end of the day, when money is placed in the hands of a greedy corporation, when they see that they can make lots of money, they'll do it. And We see it throughout today. We see it in, for example, the medical industry, right? We want, as a normal functioning human being, we want to have the best medicine. But are corporations allowing us to have access to that? No, because it's so much money, right? We want insulin, for example. It is so much money to get insulin. So are we really helping each other? Yeah, on paper, sure. But are we doing it in practice? Not really. So that's what the genre is really all about.
Thank you. All right, hey, Daniel. Yeah, love the video. We've talked a bunch about this. I think something that has occurred to me here, right, is this idea of trauma, right? Reception, yeah, through trauma, and the aesthetics and narratives are trauma. And so the reception is also right through the eyes of trauma. Coming back to race for a minute with Professor Markey's comment, right? Even Dragon Ball becoming Aryan, right? You literally become Aryan, okay, when you become powerful, right? Blonde hair, blue eyes, right? That's how that happens. And I think the question that Professor Markey was getting is, what is the answer in the text?
Okay.
Right? Like, yes, what is the answer from the texts themselves, right? How do we solve this, right? Miyazaki has a very particular answer that we've talked about, right? Embrace, right, calmness, tranquility, nature, right? You step away from the technology in a way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, other texts have different answers. Here's my question that we've talked about before. What is it about the Japanese media that has so much influence, right? It's different than K-pop. K-pop has a ton of influence, but it's different. So what is it? What is the quality about the Japanese media that you researched and you studied and you became entrenched in? What is it about that's so powerful and so meaningful in the West and Hollywood?
So I apologize for not answering the whiteness and why these characters are so white and things of that nature. So really, we stem to history and we look at how the world is, and the world has always been dominated by this whiteness. Even if you go back to the Japan, you see people of darker skin tone and they don't see it as beautiful. They villainize it in their text, in their works. A lot of these villains are darker in skin tone, for example. So it all goes back to how they perceive the color, right? And mostly over there, they don't have people of color and things of that nature. And they view whiteness as beauty. When you look at all these models over in Japan, they're very white. They view this whiteness as beautiful, powerful. And for example, in Dragon Ball, when they power up, they turn blonde hair and green eyes, very Aryan. A lot of that goes back to Nazi Germany and how they had their views. They viewed Hitler, most prominently viewed people with white hair and blue eyes as the superior race. We power over the people of color. And at the time, over Jewish people who didn't really have, I guess, who at the time didn't really fit that criteria. They viewed white hair, blue eyes as the superior race. And it shows in the text, World War II, to go back to Hiroshima Nagasaki, was huge. It was literally the World War II, and it had dramatic effects. Miyazaki talks about it throughout his works, how war can be destructive, how we should be peaceful, tranquil, and we shouldn't villainize and destroy each other in such ways. And so what makes Japanese media so beautiful in such respects is that first in the way they make their products, they make very beautiful works, a lot of smooth animation, beautiful music. And it's funny that you, it's funny because even in the community, when we talk about these things, we always say, oh, Japan, they don't really have, you know, like brown hair, blue eyes, you know, different cultures, different skin tones. It's funny because you could say they want to be like them. Because even in various works, they want to, they want to be them. They want to be the people of power. Because that's what always comes back to is power and history. And throughout history, power was white. So. That was a beautifully worded question by both professors.
I'd just like to add something to this, which is when you were talking about the cyberpunk or the cyberpunk culture, it also sort of came to mind the killer in Buffalo, the whole notion of going on his trip to do what he did. It seemed like it came right out of this stuff. I don't know. There's much more to it, but it's not unrelated. That's all.
Just to add on to that, and I guess the Japanese media in general, I just feel like because it has such an immense amount of influence on people in general, I feel like people look at these forms of media and, like you said, that it's empowering to them, you know, and the whitewashing of all of the media that they cater to, it's a form of empowerment. And when they're empowered by it, they act on it. And I feel like that's like one of the, to go back to the Buffalo thing, I feel like that's one of the main reasons for that. And like this can go back to other forms of media where there was that massacre in the theater, and it was based off of the Joker, and you know, like it just shows how powerful like the media is, and for Japanese media to have such an influence, and it's based on this whitewashing effect. It kind of downplays who you are. Mm-hmm. And like what you look up to and things like that, and sort of just confines you in a box, and that you can only be like this to mm-hmm. become powerful. You can only act like this to be, basically.
It's interesting because looking into the Buffalo shooting, the shooter posted 180 page manifesto of how, based on this one idea that the white people, just to simplify it to white people becoming the minority, and it's so strange, and it's almost like they don't like being the minority. Because why? Because they treat the minority very badly. Even they set up systems in place to treat the minority in such a way that pushes them down, that doesn't allow the same opportunity as them. And to see these white shooters do these things and post almost the same idea, it's almost like they know exactly what they've done. And it's like America, like I said, is becoming, even there are studies that say that at some point America, that POC, Latinos, Blacks, will not become the minority. They'll become at one point equal, and then another point a majority. So this whitewashing effect is so powerful. It's, you can't escape it.
Well, can you escape it? I mean, I think that's the question of art, right?
Like, yes.
Thinking about, all right, the characters in this, in a white society, not under white supremacy.
So let me to just add to that. When we talk about history, and there are times in history when white people weren't in power, but the modern world, as we say, right, came to be because white people came, they destroyed, and they created again. So now, it's almost like a cycle, right? You say, before white people ruled the world, there was these different cultures that ruled their proper societies. Now, the British came, they destroyed, they conquered, and they made a new society. And in the future, that won't be the case, right? Which is why we have all these shootings and things of that nature. We have these ideas. They have these ideas. So now we're coming to the new cycle of, eventually the new cycle of the minority will become the majority and rule society. Yeah, we have a question. Thank you, Professor.
I guess a follow-up question to try to focus what we're asking you about. 'Cause I was thinking about the way, you know, we've been talking about how does World War II get represented in a Japanese context versus how it gets represented in American context. And I was thinking about, you know, I visited Hiroshima, and one thing I remember is the American military, one of the reasons they chose those two places to bomb is they actually just wanted to test the power of the bomb because they'd spent so much money creating it. And at that point in the war, there were hardly any cities left that were not already destroyed. So really, those places were chosen because they were intact so that you could see what the bomb would do. So my question is the whiteness in those texts, is it maybe de-essentializing whiteness as like a physical property and sort of showing it as a dynamic? Like that's, I've been thinking about you saying, or I guess Ian said, like when you become powerful, you get blue eyes and blonde hair. And so I'm just wondering, so is that's showing up the power structure as opposed to making whiteness something to aspire to as an essence? And I guess where I'm coming from in that question, I don't know if that makes sense, but thinking about the fact that this poet that I read who identifies as a cyborg poet is Lebanese and trans. And so I was, you know, reading about cyborg culture as like a culture for people who feel maybe marginalized by ways that certain identities are essentialized, and just feeling like I don't fit into the categories that have been presented to me. You know, like the boxes that I get to check, like none of those boxes fit. So I guess I'm just curious if, I'm just curious if that relates to the category of whiteness as a concept that has been, you know, that has driven our history for a while. Does that make sense? Or is that me rambling?
I want to say that it made sense, but these ideas are so complicated and so entrenched in our society. How can we could trace it back in many different ways, and we can get different answers. It's really hard to answer that question in particular, if I had to admit it, because this idea of whiteness and white power is still, at the moment, it's still a thing. And how can we, to sort of ask another question to ponder is, why do we always attribute the white to power? Why do we continue to do so, for example? One could say the media I showed, for example, is 80s media, right? It reflects the ideas of their time. And nowadays, there's more different media. Like, for example, there are these creators that are going to create a black anime, right? That show of powers. That's just one example. But yeah, this idea of whiteness and white power, why do we continue to attribute it? That's still a question that we're still answering. That could still be because it reflects our times, one could say. Japanese art is a very different culture. Our media today, we represent many different things, but over there, it's still different. Their ideas or their issues with culture, different cultures, is not like ours. We're a mosaic. We can't directly address the issues, but over there, it's still very white. I forgot the word that says that they're 99% of the same. I forgot the word for it. Homogenous. So it's like they don't have the same issues. Right over here, yeah, we could dissect it, and culturally we can properly digest, dissect it, and things of that nature. Over there, it's just different due to the 99% homogenous. And until things change, right, more different cultures go over there. There are black creators that go over there. They face racism. They're viewed as these great wonders. Oh, there's a black person in our neighborhood. It's almost like they're walking wonders. And they still have to tackle that. And they have to take their media and they have to properly break it down to where they can say, oh, why are we doing this to black people? And things of that nature. That was a ramble, but it was an attempt to answer your question, Professor.
I was just gonna to answer sort of your question and to like add on. I feel like it's just a form of brainwashing. So we'll never actually, well, at least now, I feel like we'll never actually move past this whiteness in the media, even when stereotypes are being broken within the media. It's like still, there's always just that one factor. And even within anime, when they do have people of color, they don't look like a person of color. They just have that skin tint, you know? Yeah. But they have the features of the other white characters, you know? So I feel like, you know, we're just stuck in a bubble, and there's times when we look at some of these characters that or anime that are breaking the boundaries, and they are breaking the normal stereotypes, and then we look at it and we're like, why? You know, like we can take comics, for example, when certain comics try to break certain boundaries, even though in the comics they're actually written in a specific way, but when they're taken into real life adaption, people are saying things like, well, that didn't need to be changed. One example could be, it's not a comic, but let's take A Little Mermaid, for example, and how the live action version they want to make Ariel a black woman. Mm. And people are like, why? Why would we even do that? She's white in the movie. It's also animated, and she's a mermaid, so it's like who really cares, you know? That's not a real. I mean, that's another argument, but you know. So I just don't feel like we'll ever really move forward, because this is also like, it's not only in America. So obviously in Japan and Korea and other Asian countries, we can even go into India as well. And then in Africa, there's places like Libya, and they're pushing out these products that, you know, cater to whiteness. And I just don't think that we'll ever really move forward. Like, we could step forward while taking a step backward. You know, like, yeah, this happened, but this is also still there. Or, yeah, we accomplished that, but that's also still there.
you know. So yeah, I just think that's how it's just gonna keep going until. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's.
That's why we're here.
Yeah. It's interesting. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Percy Jackson series by Rick Riordan. He's in collaboration with Disney. He's making a new adaptation of his books, and one of the characters, Annabeth Chase, has always been portrayed as white. Even in the book, she's blonde hair, gray eyes. And so Rick Riordan decided, very meticulously, he says, she is the best actress for this role. She's black, and she doesn't fit the normal stereotype, the normal picture of we have of Annabeth Chase. So you're right, right? There's always that one thing that the one thing in terms of whiteness that we'll have to get over, right? Even when we portray characters on screen, happens a lot in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, for example. Nick Fury, white. Who plays him? The famous Samuel Jackson. Does a great job at it. Yeah. And right. But we want that. We want producers, content creators to allow these people of color to play these roles. Why? Because they, number one, because they could play the role. They could play it better than the actress who looks like them. Right? And we want different representation of these characters. We want black people to play these. We want, you know, for example, this actress to play Annabeth Chase. Why? Because we trust that Rick Riordan says, oh, she could play the best role. Right? So that was a ramble again.
Very quickly, I just want to say a few things, and I know we're totally out of time. I know we're totally out of time, but and we've gone way over. We'll just say that these questions are tough and super huge. Daniel and I have not discussed the history of World War II in Japan and trauma. That was not in our discussions. We didn't quite get into the dynamics of racism and institutional racism in Japan, right? We didn't quite get to there. The project, right, to bring it a little bit smaller, right, to bring it a little bit smaller is to say that Japanese media has had lots and lots of influence, right, sort of small, on American media, which created all of these hybrid pieces of content, which is exemplified by a Kingdom Hearts, where yeah. Disney is with Final Fantasy, right, where Disney is with the Japanese RPG. Right. This is a very, very popular genre. And then in the 80s, there were these digital communication technologies starting to boom that was creating the transnational cultural flows that exist. So somebody like me at a particular era could go to Games and James at 42nd Street, get the bootlegged VHS tapes that were then subtitled by the guys who worked at Games and James. And so it's a you know, it's you know, those are the two or three points that I think that the project makes it a little bit smaller than, of course, these huge, huge questions. But the third point, which is that you argue and we've talked about, is that these texts bring out conversations that are much larger and much broader, right? That's the point of intertextuality. And so we've proven the point, but we didn't quite, right? We didn't quite get to those sorts of places, and those are tough questions.
And
so,
let me just say, I appreciate all the questions. These are very hard questions, but they're very necessary questions. Why? Because we, as Americans, have to tackle these questions. As people that study media, people that create media, we have to always tackle these questions, because we want to break down these ideas. And so while my project doesn't specifically answer all those questions, that is an important piece to look at in the future. And I hope that we can all look at it and break down these things together. And that was just my final point. Thank you, everybody. Thanks for.
Hello, everybody. My name is Stephen Carbajal, and I am majoring in media communications and minoring in marketing. Over the past couple years, I've had the opportunity to complete incredible internships in amazing companies working directly with the marketing teams and brand managers. Throughout that time, I developed an interest in brand management and entrepreneurship, which has led me here. I have selected to develop an integrative marketing communications plan for the skincare brand First Aid Beauty for my capstone project. I focused on a diversity, equity, and inclusion campaign with a concentration on the Hispanic consumer. In this presentation, I will start off with the background, then discuss the creative strategy, explain how social media and digital marketing play a significant role, and then event proposal ideas before concluding with the bibliography. With over 500,000 Instagram followers, First Aid Beauty is a relatively popular personal care brand focused on solving skin challenges. Its formulas strictly adhere to 5 core standards, prioritizing the safety of sensitive skin, zero fragrances, cruelty-free, dermatologist-tested, and clean ingredients. The brand's dedication to creating non-irritating, safe formulas is its key differentiator in the market that sells products that often disrupt the skin's barrier. This allows the brand to continuously generate 25 to 50 million in annual revenue sales. For this proposed strategy, our goal is to diversify the existing consumer base by targeting Hispanic women, ages 18 to 35. Generation Z and millennials are among the most diverse groups the census has ever seen. As Hispanic are the second largest ethnic minority group, with a buying power of $1.7 trillion, we will focus on the middle-class market in the United States. According to OI and its 2018 Hispanic Beauty Market Research Report, Hispanic women spend 23% more than any other demographic on beauty products, averaging $275 per year, making this demographic a crucial group to create solutions for and market around. Lifestyle plays an important role in figuring out what products align to our consumers. Generation Z and millennial Hispanic women are collectivists. Hispanic culture is interdependent, with a work as a group, sacrifice as a group mentality. Family and community comes first, especially as an ethnic group that tends to live within multi-generational households. 54% of Hispanics are bilingual, although many younger generations prefer English. Due to this collectivist and interdependence ideas, Hispanic buyers are easily influenced by recommendations in digital media. Word of mouth marketing will be an essential tool in our strategy. Once loyalty is obtained, this group becomes increasingly active and will serve as our key marketers. First Aid Beauty offers products that complement a variety of skin-based problems for even the most sensitive skin types. Overall, this makes the company the safest and most reliable prestige skincare option. Hispanic women's top skin concerns are open pores, acne, and dark spots. Desiring a well-balanced product line that boosts skin health and beauty. To garner a loyal Hispanic consumer base, First Aid Beauty must highlight products that speak to these needs and create solutions for their issues. The business objective is to generate awareness and engagement with the Latina consumer to increase sales by 15% by 2025. Our key message throughout the campaign will be First Aid Beauty is an ally to the Hispanic community, elevating and celebrating the diversity of all skin types, of all skin tones, for all people, truly emphasizing the idea for all, as the Hispanic demographic is an extremely diverse in itself. We want to become a brand people can look to as a leader in the space when it comes to embracing diversity and being true to one's own skin. The problem to solve is currently there is a significant disconnect with the Hispanic consumer as they lack representation on social media and website embracing this community. This serves as a loss for First Aid Beauty as this demographic leads in the prestige beauty category. Moreover, we want to drive brand awareness through culturally relevant, purpose-driven partnerships and promotions. We want to be an advocate for the Hispanic community while also addressing those t- top skin concerns with the efficacy of our products. These stats paint the picture. 43% of Hispanic millennials feel favorable towards brands that include aspects of their culture and advertising, so we need to make them feel involved. 65% of Latinos feel invisible in the beauty and personal grooming ads. So our solution is we must incorporate models and diverse models with diverse skin types and body types. As we all know, social media is one of the most effective ways to reach a large number of people. As a result, I've devised a two-tiered marketing plan in the hopes of engaging our target group and inspiring loyalty. To achieve our business objectives, we will use organic social media and paid media and email marketing to figure out ways to communicate with our set group, making them feel heard and seen. Strategy 1, communications objective, will focus on building impactful brand awareness among the Hispanic audience. Amplifying First Aid Beauty's relevant product lines among Hispanic circles with these dedicated platforms like Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, and TikTok. Organic media is a terrific way to develop your relationship with your customer and audience base using free social media platforms. Building and engaging your online following through strong content is essential. For example, infographics can be used to discuss products, ingredients, and even highlight testimonials on various skin types. Furthermore, video content may be used to create an interactive experience with your consumer via demonstrating skincare regimens and posing challenges. All of this is fairly inexpensive and just takes some creativity. On the other hand, paid media focuses on external marketing efforts that involve a paid placement. Hence, why this approach will pay for certain ad placements that capture a large Hispanic audience viewership, such as meta ads in certain pages or commercials in television stations such as Univision and Telemundo, truly stretching out the marketing dollars and getting our message across. Strategy 2's concentration is aimed at improving sales among Hispanic consumers. This will be accomplished by increasing website traffic through culturally relevant partnerships. This is strongly related to the marketing funnel from the first phase of learning about what the business offers to purchasing stage. Similarly to the first strategy, we will be on platforms such as Instagram, Facebook. This time we'll be using email marketing, but we'll also be using YouTube and TikTok. Brand partnerships are essential, as 93% of Hispanics believe that companies that make a sincere effort to be part or invest in my community deserve my loyalty. With impactful partnerships, we can create a gift with purchase, GWP. With a small Hispanic-owned business, creating an opportunity for the purchase segment during Hispanic Heritage Month. Anyone who buys our products will receive an item from the Hispanic-owned business as a gift brought to you by First Aid Beauty. Offering a GWP gives consumers the impression that they are getting more value while also boosting the chance of creating loyal customers by solid word-of-mouth marketing. Lastly, gift with purchases are usually unique and limited, which increases conversion rates by installing urgency in consumers' purchasing decision. Email marketing is one of the most successful methods for increasing client engagement and sales. As a result, I believe it is critical to send monthly newsletters to Hispanic consumers outlining products and value offerings they can take advantage of. Hispanics tend to live in multi-generational households, and their value size would make it important for them to understand that they can buy multiple stuff. In this newsletter, we will send promotions and discounts to loyal consumers while also encouraging others to sign up using their email addresses to receive incentives. Some key metrics to determine the success of these strategies will be the engagement. How many comments are we receiving? How many shares are our posts getting? At the same time, conversion. How many people are going to our website and buying a specific product, or the bounce rates? This is all important to figure out the weaknesses and strengths of our strategies. Being seen where it counts matters. For those reasons, being present in large diverse events like BeautyCon can be a deciding factor for people giving a product a try. BeautyCon labels itself as a fashion and beauty summit, but it is basically all of your favorite beauty gurus and YouTubers in one location. Consumers are welcome to meet their favorite influencers while learning about new beauty products, watching performances, and much more. First Aid Beauty will host a booth at BeautyCon this summer, spearheaded by key Hispanic ambassadors, among other representatives. This is significant since 65% of Latinos feel invisible in the beauty and personal grooming advertisements. So having someone who looks like them represent the brand adds trust. Additionally, 80% of Latinos prefer companies that have models from a diverse range of ages, ethnicities, and body types and body shapes. Therefore, having ambassadors that fit these criteria at an in-person event will make Hispanics feel more at ease as they try out the products in the booth and conduct product-related conversations. It will be important to pick the right ambassadors. For this reason, I have chosen both micro and macro influencers that are highly respected in the Latina community, with the first being Lena Kennedy, a board-certified dermatologist, bringing that credibility to our brand. Second, Iris Belin, an Afro-Latina beauty influencer who has built a loyal following. And lastly, Melissa Tovar, a lifestyle influencer who is big on TikTok, introducing those younger consumers to the brand. With all these ideas, the goal is to create a more equitable brand that Hispanics feel comfortable representing, while at the same time increasing a loyal consumer base. Thank you to everyone who has taken the time to listen. If you want to look at my detailed IMCP document with metrics and statistics on my capstone and the whole creative magazine that I've designed, I will be sharing it with my professor. Thank you, everyone.
Hello, everyone. My name is Shania Rentes, and I did my capstone project on the topic of the correlation between social media and body image issues. So for this topic, I basically centered an entire digital magazine website on the article that I wrote for this, which I will get into in more detail in a second. So about the digital magazine, the digital magazine allows for readers and site visitors to sign up and become a member of a discussion group right here. So this, the Current Times discussion group, allows you to basically share your opinions, and it allows for valuable and insightful conversation to take place as members share their thoughts and opinions on the topic of the week. So the topic of the week tab leads you to the article/research paper about social media's correlation to body image issues in young women and girls. The weekly announcement tab serves the purpose of introducing the topic to readers/site visitors. The reader submissions tab is something I included after gathering answers from interviews I conducted on girls and young women regarding their thoughts on the topic and whether or not social media has affected their body image. So I basically condensed the gist of their answers into this reader submissions tab right here. So this is a screenshot, just a little portion of it. Of course, there's more to it if you were to actually visit the website. And then the gallery tab just shows the virtual ethnography portion of my research, in which I had to gather evidence about social media's impact on body image through observing the interactions I saw in comment sections. From this, I gathered that young girls in TikTok comment sections are most vocal and open about their body image and the way they feel when they see someone who they wish to look like. So the gallery will lead you to these screenshots of, you know, comments that I've seen and everything that I've observed, and also videos of conversations on the topic and how it's a pretty hot topic on social media, especially recently. So the topic of the week tab, as I said, takes you to the article/research paper that I wrote about social media's correlation to body image issues. And since my project is centered on this one topic, and the Current Times isn't a legitimate publication, there are of course no more articles. However, This entire website is just a concept I created for what could become a legitimate publication. So with that being said, here are some of the main points to gather from the article. So instead of actually reading the entire article, I'm just going to highlight the main points of the entire article. So the instantaneous access to social media increases the chances of body image issues becoming an exponentially growing concern. Conventional media kickstarted the perpetuation of beauty standards. So for example, magazines, television, movies, etc. Beauty standards are set by society as a whole and can change over time. Beauty standards can vary in parts of the world, and as conventional media is declining, social media use is increasing. So this means that perpetuation of beauty standards are now more accessible, and young women and girls are likely to try to attain the beauty standards being perpetuated on social media. Trends in young women going to desperate lengths in order to fit the beauty standards are also of concern. So this is the, once you click on this, it leads you, first you would click on this, and then you would click on the topic of the week. And then after you click that, you just click on the actual topic, which will lead you to the article. So these are just screenshots of what you would see on the website if you visit it. So what is body image and what factors play into self-perception? So body image is how someone views themselves and their appearance, whether it be negatively or positively. Environmental factors play into how you perceive yourself. So for example, the household you grew up in, the school or schools you've attended, the people you surround yourself with, etc. Society as a whole is a major factor in shaping body image due to the existence of beauty standards. Because we are now living in a society where everything is digital and posts can be shared online, this opens up doors for more factors that could potentially shape your body image. So, using social media to display an idealized version of yourself. So millions of people post pictures of themselves on social media, and oftentimes people use photo manipulation techniques, whether heavy or subtle, in order to showcase the best version of themselves. So basically, things like an app called Facetune, if anyone is familiar with that. Facetune is an app that is very popular, that is used by a lot of people, especially for Instagram. And a lot of people get called out for Facetuning their photos and basically becoming like an entire different person. Like their appearance just completely changes. Of course, not everyone does it, but the app is kind of insane how you can actually change your entire look. So that is an issue. Through experiments and studies, it was concluded that seeing positive likes and comments has proven to increase levels of self-objectification and the desire to earn positive feedback from strangers and or friends or family on self-images posted to social media. Women have been conditioned to obsess over aesthetics and their appearance. So this goes hand in hand as to why cosmetic industries such as makeup and cosmetic surgery are worth billions. Young women oftentimes get cosmetic procedures that are consistent with what is considered desirable in a woman's physical feature. So for example, Brazilian butt lift, otherwise known as a BBL, breast augmentations, lip fillers, etc. These are all just examples of procedures that are especially popular in today's society. The increasing trend of these procedures have resulted in warnings by the CDC about traveling outside the US for a cheaper price on procedures. A result of a study/experiment conducted came to the conclusion that viewing images of women who have cosmetic enhancements made young women desire cosmetic surgery. These results were especially true for young women who spent a significant amount of time on social media. Another experiment came to the conclusion that exposure to manipulated photos resulted in low body satisfaction and confidence. Exposure to bullying and body shaming. Social media makes it easy for people to harshly criticize appearances. This is a form of bullying that's known as body shaming. body shaming can take a toll on mental health as it can reduce confidence, influence eating habits, so basically anorexia or things like bulimia, and just overall restricting your diet, starving yourself, or maybe even sometimes eating too much to look a certain way. It just depends on the person and how it affects them. So another result of body shaming can be heightened levels of distress. So of course, if you see a lot of negative comments on your posts or people criticizing your body, of course, that's gonna just take a toll on your mental health and how you feel about yourself. So body shaming on social media can also influence someone's desire for cosmetic surgery, which only feeds into the issue. So if anything, it can potentially create another issue in which that person may now be criticized for being too plastic or fake. So basically, it's a double-edged sword, especially for women. You know, it's either they're not naturally attractive enough, and once they, you know, get something done, get a procedure done, they're criticized for being fake. So that's the point that I was making there. So further consequences, mental health issues such as body dysmorphic disorder, which is a hyperfixation on flaws that may or may not exist. So, you know, bullying and body shaming can potentially make you see things that you didn't see before. And just make you focus on them excessively, which is a form of body dysmorphia. This can also lead to an addiction to cosmetic procedures. So you can become addicted to breast augmentation. You can become addicted to lip filler. I myself have seen people addicted to cosmetic procedures. So yeah, that is also an issue that can arise. Another consequence is taking risky measures to get procedures done. So medical tourism is an example of this, as many women travel to foreign countries to get surgery at a cheaper cost. However, oftentimes the results can turn out to be botched, which can lead to more body image issues, or they may get an infection due to medical malpractice. Less strict regulations in other countries, surgeons not being board certified, unsanitary conditions, complications during or after surgery, and even death. So these are just very dangerous and risky things that can happen due to someone's decision to get surgery, especially if it's outside of the U.S. Either way, there's always a risk, whether outside of the U.S. or in the U.S., there's always a risk of something going wrong. Especially when it comes to just contamination and bacteria due to getting in your open wounds when getting surgery or anything like that. So basically, an example of this is Tanya McDougall. I described and detailed her story in the article, but a quick and brief summary of it is that she traveled to the Dominican Republic for a tummy tuck and a BBL. And she ended up leaving with an infection from a mycobacteria she contracted from non-sterile equipment and contaminated water used during the procedures. And of course, a lot of this happens because there's not enough restrictions. There's not the same types of restrictions that there are in the U.S. And a lot of surgeons are surprisingly not even board certified, which is extremely risky. So and not a lot of women do their research beforehand either, because they're so desperate to fit beauty standards and mimic what they see other women looking like online. So yeah, these are just desperate measures, and unfortunately they do have consequences for a lot of women. So as a conclusion, body image is shaped by the world around you and the aspects of it that you consume the most. Social networking being the most consumed aspect of society. There's more instant access to things that may shape your body image, such as body shaming / bullying, exposure to cosmetic procedures, exposure to manipulated / edited photos, like Facetune, as I mentioned, which can all lead to other young women and girls to want to fit the standards that they see. which leads to a cycle that is still unfolding at the present time. So social media is very relevant today, and it's still relevant. There's really no say in when it'll come to an end, so it's still unfolding. But this is basically the gist of everything that I spoke about. There's, of course, a lot of details in the article, and more details on the experiments that were conducted and the studies that were conducted. But if you go to the website right here, you will see, you will be able to get more information on everything that I wrote about. But with that being said, thank you for listening, and I hope that this was an informative, or at least gave you a little bit of an idea of what my project is about and what the website overall aims to do. And yeah, thank you.
Social Media Impacts on Students by Talisa Arias.
I can hear that very well.
Social media has become the modern way of communicating and staying connected. According to the University of Canada West, social media has taken over the business, advertising, and education sectors. It has had a long-lasting impact on how people communicate and has now become a vital part of our lives. For example, WhatsApp. It has completely transformed the culture of instant messaging. If you have internet connection, you can text anyone anywhere in the world. This revolution has been brought not only by WhatsApp, but also by Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and Instagram. Although social media is a great platform to use, this in many cases has resulted in consequences like anxiety and depression among teenagers who may feel like they don't really fit in, and at times take drastic measures.
Forwarding it, so yeah, maybe we can autoplay.
Here are some social media logos such as Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Pinterest, YouTube, WhatsApp. I can't really name absolutely all of them, but there are some logos of social media platforms. Social media beauty standards have led young girls, especially adolescents, to get discouraged in life. Young girls with low self-esteem may lack confidence in their abilities and even fail to see their full potential. This has led to poor performance, even accelerated the rate of school dropouts. Beauty standards have also been set to unrealistic standards. Many apps and filters have been created to alter and beautify pictures. This, in turn, creating pressures on teenagers who feel like they do not fit in those standards because they don't believe they're as perfect as those apps and filters make others appear to be. A study in 2017 showed that more than 500,000 students in the United States had depressive and suicidal thoughts related to smartphones and in particular social media. There was an increase in the percentage of students with depression due to social media, 33% between the years 2010 and 2015. In the same period, the suicide rate for girls in that age group increased by 65%.
Yeah, so I'll just keep moving it. Oh, this image.
Social media also undoubtedly triggers the comparison of people with others based on other success, body image, etc. Self-awareness is important for individuals to understand that they cannot see everything just by what they see physically. While one can see other people's success, progress, and beauty on social media, it is important to remember that nobody posts their failures. Therefore, instead of being stressed or pressured by seeing their progress, just channel that energy into motivating to do better from the inside out and not the other way around. Also, we are all going to evolve in our time when our time is right. So timing in life is absolutely everything, and we have to understand that. A certain percentage of teenagers have succumbed to the pressure, which has affected their self-esteem. With low self-esteem, social anxiety causes the children to run away from social gatherings. This has resulted in many teenagers dropping out of school for not feeling good enough. A search of Psych Info, Medline, Embase, and a few others databases reaped 13 eligible studies, 12 of which were cross-sectional. Findings were related to depression, anxiety, and psychological distress. Hashtag together is better. This kind of emphasizes the importance to expose ourselves to inspiring content as opposed to triggering ones that poke our insecurities.
This was a website she made.
I created a website as part of my capstone project. It was created to be a safe space for parents, students, and teachers. Apart from feeling inadequate, teenagers go through cyberbullying from their peers, which...
Sorry, I'm going to just go to the site. Oh, actually, I don't have the thing, so you can watch it in a little bit. I'll see you in a second.
In conclusion, it is clear to see that social media undoubtedly affects the esteem of adolescents. It is therefore important to expose ourselves to inspiring content as opposed to triggering ones that poke our insecurities. Social media is an open platform that depends on its audience's interest, but its algorithms strive what they can and cannot see. So ultimately, its openness should be questioned.
Okay, so I think that's it for all of our presenters. Congratulations to everybody. It was really good work. And I'm glad we actually managed to have the first annual Capstone Symposium, and hopefully we can do many more of them in the future. Thanks to Eileen and everyone else who supported this